Over 2 years ago, AMD heavily disrupted the CPU market with the launch of the first Ryzen processors. Since then, they've made steady, incremental improvements in terms of performance, usability, and power efficiency. But how do these first-gen CPUs actually perform today? So in today's video, we want to answer two questions. First of all, at the heavily discounted prices that you can get the first-gen Ryzen processors for, are they actually worth buying over second and third gen? For example, the Ryzen 5 1600 usually pops up for around $100 or so, so that could be a steal depending on performance. Second of all, I know a lot of you guys were early adopters of the Ryzen platform, and most of you have first gen Ryzen CPUs in your build right now. So is the performance margin from first gen up to third generation worth it for gaming and production workloads? That's what we're going to be finding out today. So the processor that I want to revisit today is the Ryzen 5 1600, seeing as that was without a doubt the most popular choice from the Zen lineup. This CPU was a big shock to the market, given that Intel's competitor at the time was the quad-core non-hyperthreaded i5-7600K, whereas the Ryzen 5 1600 boasted 6 cores and 12 threads. Now, even if you've never owned a Ryzen CPU, and let's say you've just recently built a PC with an 8th gen or 9th gen Intel CPU, you at least owe a small thanks to AMD. They brought a serious amount of competition to the market, and it's very unlikely that we would otherwise be seeing 6-core i5s and 8-core i7s if it weren't for them. Of course, it wasn't all sunshine and rainbows for AMD back then, and introducing an entirely new architecture to the market did see distressing compatibility issues and road bumps. Memory speeds were the most common issue with first generation Ryzen CPUs. Some common 3200 MHz kits, for example, would really struggle past even 2666 MHz, whereas today 3200 MHz memory is natively supported for the third gen Ryzen CPU lineup. Now, for this testing, I was able to get a Samsung BDI 32GB kit of 3200 MHz memory, stable on even the Ryzen 5 1600. However, when alongside a CPU overclock, the DRAM voltage did need to be bumped up to 1.5 volts. Regular memory kits, though, that aren't using BDI modules may still have issues achieving their full advertised speeds. In terms of CPU overclocking, I was able to stretch the Ryzen 5 1600 up to 3.9 GHz at 1.41 volts. The R5 2600 was able to push a bit further at 4.1 GHz, and my 3600 sample was stable at 4.2 GHz. In the upcoming graphs, the R5 3600 is definitely the CPU that you'll want to keep your eyes on. The performance leap here from the 2600 and 1600 is pretty significant. So let's jump right in, starting with production workloads with the very popular Cinebench R20. This indicates how these CPUs will perform in the Cinema 4D software by Maxon. Here, the Ryzen 5 1600, which will be illustrated in orange for all of the following graphs, shows a really healthy performance even by today's standards. It outperforms Intel's current i5-9400 even when left at stock, and when overclocked to 3.9 GHz, it does surpass the stock R5 2600. The 3600, on the other hand, has a massive 48% lead over the 1600 and a 29% lead over the 2600. Switching over to a single thread, though, this is where the first gen Ryzen series falls short. Or from another perspective, this is an area where AMD have improved dramatically. Single threaded performance in Cinema 4D shows the R5 3600 20% ahead of the 2600 and a massive 54% ahead of the 1600. More importantly, third gen Ryzen is about on par with Intel in this benchmark. In Blender, though, the Ryzen 5 1600 does get beaten by the i5-9400F, and we do gain quite a bit of speed from overclocking. As always, if you are in a position where you can leverage your GPU for rendering in this program, then that would be preferable. The Ryzen 5 3600, on the other hand, is slightly faster than Intel's i7-9700K, even when the i7 is overclocked to 5 GHz. Looking at export times in Premiere Pro, it seems that this software doesn't really care for the additional threads, at least when it comes to video encoding. Perhaps for video playback and scrubbing, though, the extra threads on Ryzen could be beneficial. Here, the 2600 was 6% faster than the 1600, and the 3600 was 23% faster than the 2600. File compression in 7-zip has always been a strong point for the Ryzen processors, as this software can properly utilize those extra threads. Here, the first-gen Ryzen 5 CPU is able to beat Intel's current locked i5 offerings. However, an overclocked 9600K might be able to close that gap by a little. An overclocked 3600 in this benchmark showed to be about on par with the significantly more expensive i7-9700K. File decompression showed even stronger results. Here, the 3600 is actually faster than the current-gen i7, even when that CPU is overclocked. And the 1600 is showing some strong performance too, 30% faster than the i5-9400F. Okay, now let's move on to gaming, and although the strong multi-threading performance of the R5-1600 is still performing quite well today, gaming performance is something that AMD have improved on significantly. In Shadow of the Tomb Raider, the 2600 was around 9% faster than the 1600, and the 3600 was around 26% faster than the 1600. So if you're considering upgrading from the 1600 to the 3600, that would be a pretty sensible upgrade. In Far Cry 5, there's a 29% performance margin between them at stock, which is absolutely massive. Given that it's a simple BIOS update and a CPU swap, it's a pretty easy upgrade as well. Project Cars 2 is a heavily CPU intensive title, especially when played at high frame rates. A stock Ryzen 5 1600 will give you about half of the possible frames when compared to when there isn't a CPU bottleneck, as demonstrated with the overclocked 9700K or 9900K. Battlefield 5 plays fairly similarly, although it is a bit fairer to the Ryzen CPUs here. Overclocking the Ryzen 5 1600 shows an 11% improvement in average FPS, bringing gaming performance a lot closer to the Ryzen 2600. World War Z running the Vulkan API shows a similar story. Overclocking the 1600 can give you a pretty nice boost in performance and bring it very close to the overclocked 2600 performance, but the 3600 is just in another league entirely. In this title, the current gen i5s actually perform pretty exceptionally too. Just note that the 6 threads might be maxed out in some titles. Keep in mind, these benchmarks are at 1080p and are also at high frame rates. If you're gaming closer to the 60 FPS mark, then the 1600's performance will be a lot closer to the rest of the stack. If high frame rate gaming is something that you are interested in though, again, definitely have your eyes on that 3600. Lastly, in Assassin's Creed Odyssey, we see a 10% boost in performance stepping up from first gen to second gen, and then an additional 19% stepping up to third gen. The 3600's performance in this title particularly is quite impressive. So, are the first generation Ryzen CPUs worth it today for gaming? Probably not, unless you can get it for a really good price. I mean, let's take the Ryzen 5 1600 for example. When the Ryzen 2600 is around $115 at the moment, I probably wouldn't pay more than about $70 to $80 for a Ryzen 5 1600. The R5 3600 on the other hand is quite a bit more expensive at $195, but it does have the performance to back it up. For multi-threading performance though, I really think these first gen Ryzen CPUs are a great option. Let's say you want to build a video editing machine on a budget, and let's say you have $70 to $80 to allocate for the CPU, you could definitely go for a Ryzen 5 1600 over, say, an Intel i3, which only has 4 cores and 4 threads. If you do currently own a first generation Ryzen CPU, an upgrade to third gen is going to be pretty tempting after seeing those performance margins. In most cases, you're looking at around a 30% improvement, which is definitely going to be noticeable. Even if you have a second generation CPU like the 2600, the margins there were around 20% when compared to the 3600 for gaming, rendering and encoding. So if you are considering an upgrade up to the third generation processors, I will leave some links down below in the description. As always guys, a huge thanks for watching, and I will see you all in the next one.